In this video lecture, we're going to talk about a subset of Java classes which are exceptions to the normal rules. These are classes which are not used with individual object instances, and we call these static classes. Okay, let's get started. So at this point, we've talked about classes as being the basic building blocks of any Java program. Using classes as our blueprints, we've shown how to create individual instances of those classes, or objects. Once we have an object of a particular class on hand, we can then make use of any of its methods using dot notation. The important thing we've emphasized to this point is that methods are never called in isolation, but rather always in the context of existing objects. It's always object dot method, as we see here. For example, let's say that we create a CS12 date object called Halloween and a string object called label, with both objects shown here in blue. Then if we want to do anything with these objects, we can call their various available methods, shown here in red, but only in the context of some specific object. For example, the setDate method of the CS12Date class is called upon the Halloween object, and the two uppercase and length methods of the string class are called upon the label object. In all cases, it's object.method, as we see here. This is the typical and the usual way of writing object-oriented code. We sometimes refer to these as object methods. But we didn't really give you the full story. Your mother and I weren't completely honest with you. As with anything, there are exceptions to the general principle, which we want to discuss next. The exceptions to the usual object methods are called static methods, or sometimes class methods. The key difference between object methods and static methods is that static methods are called without having to instantiate any specific object of the class. Static methods are called from client application code using the class name rather than in the context of any specific object using the usual dot notation. Here's the general form of calling some static method. It's class name dot method name, with the class name as always beginning with a capital letter and shown here in green. For example, we'll be taking a look at the math class shortly, and one of its methods returns the absolute value of any number. All the methods of the math class, as we'll see, are static methods. So to call this method, it's math.abs with some input value, and this entire right-hand side expression is the numerical value of the absolute value. Notice that there's no math class object created. Here, math is the name of the class itself and not any object. To create any static method, all we need to do is simply add the static keyword before the method return type, as shown here. So here is the method interface for the absolute value method. The name of the method is abs. It accepts a double type input value. It returns a double type result. And the entire method is a static method. Why do we have static methods anyway? What static really means is that its elements belong to the overall class, rather than to any one specific object instance of the class. Static methods are often useful because they can provide quick and dirty one-time capability for specific operations. They don't require us to create and maintain individual objects or waste system resources when what we really want to do is just some one simple one-time thing. As a prime example, consider the main method interface shown here, which we've seen many times now, and we've said that every Java application requires there to be at least one of. If you think about it, this is a classic chicken and the egg problem. When you begin execution of some program at time zero, there hasn't yet been the opportunity to create any objects yet, so there can be no objects to call the main method upon. We cannot do the usual object.method thing, so we must call the main method in the absence of any specific objects. And this, therefore, is why the main method is itself a static method. It's called in the absence of any specific object. We want to run the method once, and then we're done with it until next time. Here are some other examples of where we might encounter static methods, and we'll be going over these in the coming several lecture topics. For example, we said that the methods of the math class are static methods. If we want to perform some simple mathematical calculations, we really don't want to have to create math objects and carry them around when all we want is just a simple result. If we want to get some input value from a user using a pop-up dialog box, We just want to quickly throw up that dialog box, get the result, and move on, without the overhead of instantiating some dialog box object. And as we'll see shortly, in the context of using pop-up dialogs for user input, we'll soon need a way to convert from text input to numerical values. And for this, we'll use several data type wrapper methods. As you might imagine, all of these are example situations where we might need just some quick and dirty one-time functionality without having to carry around any object instances for the ride. These are situations where static methods will come into play. To compare and contrast object methods versus static methods, let's take a look back at an example we've already seen when talking about methods. You may want to take a moment now to pull up the indicated source code example files in JGrasp and perhaps revisit their short code walkthrough video. On the left side, we see the Method Examples class, which is simply a collection of three short methods to add three numbers, calculate a percentage, and print a formatted message, along with another method which itself calls the other three methods internally. To use these methods, we must first create a method examples object using a default constructor, as shown here. Now, the observant among you might recognize that there are no constructors specified in the method examples class, which means this is simply an automatically created constructor, but we're kind of glossing over that fact for now. The important point here is that we are creating a new object, OBJ. Then once we have this object on hand, notice that we can call any of the methods on the left using dot notation together with the OBJ object. This is the object.method usage form, and we have five instances of this in the client program on the right, as shown here, 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 and here. Again, this is the usual and typical way of doing things in object-oriented programming. By contrast, here is the exact same utility class on the left side, except that the class has been renamed to Method Static Examples, and now each of the methods has become a static method by introduction of this extra static keyword to its interface. Other than that, each of these methods is exactly the same as before. Because these are now static methods, how we call or invoke them has now changed in this updated client application on the right. For starters, notice that there is no longer any creation of any object needed. Now, we are calling the same five methods in the same way, except that instead of calling them in the context of some object, now we are calling them using the name of the class itself. Here, there is no intervening object involved. It's instead class.method. Please take a moment now to pause this video and view the short code walkthrough video for methodstaticexamples.java and methodstaticexamplesclient.java. Open up these files in JGrasp so you can follow along. You'll find these examples in the usual place. Come back to this video when you are finished. We just saw an example of a class containing several static methods. Well, it turns out that we can also have classes which contain static data as well. Data in Java programs becomes static when it is declared using the static keyword before its data type. Such static data is not specific to each individual object instance, but instead belongs to the class as a whole. One typical usage of static data might be to keep track of how many individual instances or objects of that class have been created. Each time a new object instance is created, its constructor would increment that one common static count variable, and every such object would have access to that one shared count variable. We'll take a closer look at this later in the course when we learn how to create our own classes, but for now we'll let it go at this. One very common usage of static data is for named static constants, or class constants, such as for the math class or the color class. Just as for static methods, static constants are accessed using their class name rather than in the context of any specific object. For example, there is a math constant for pi called math.pi and a specific RGB color value called color.blue. Notice that in each case, as per good conventions, the name of the class is capitalized to indicate that it is a class, and that the variable name is capitalized to indicate that it is a constant. But wait a minute! Didn't we say earlier that one of the good practices of object-oriented programming was to keep all data as private and only access it using public accessor and mutator methods? Wasn't the goal to prevent outside corruption of data by preventing any direct access to that data, thereby maintaining data encapsulation? Well, it turns out that here, for static constants, we are still maintaining the spirit of data encapsulation by typically always declaring such data as final, which means that once its value is set internally, it cannot be changed. So even for static constants, even though we reference them by name directly without using accessor or get methods, we also can't alter their values anyway by using mutator or set methods. We do this simply because in such cases, it's often just easier to have direct access by name to such constant data. As always in life, there's often the fine print. Here are the restrictions when using static methods. Static methods can only access other outside class-level static data. They cannot access any instance variables of their class, for the simple reason that it's entirely possible that no objects of that class might yet exist. Note the careful use of the word outside here. Of course, any method can always refer to or access any variables which are locally declared inside that method. Here we are only referring to the access to any outside data. And finally, static methods can only directly call or invoke other static methods. As our go-to example, consider again the main method. We've now been reminded that the main method is in fact a static method. At program startup, there are no other objects yet in existence to call the main method upon. So to be truly standalone, and to get the program execution ball in motion, the main method must itself be static. Therefore, if you want to carve up your program into additional methods, which will be located within the same class as main itself, and you want to call those methods directly by name from main, any such methods must also themselves be declared as static. So to sum up the preceding discussion, here is a revised generic class structure diagram. As we've said, now there are two types of data and methods, the added type being static, as shown here in green. These static methods can only access other static data, such as here. These static methods cannot access any normal object-specific instance variable data, since no objects of this type might yet exist. Also, the static methods can only directly call other static methods of this class. However, the converse is not true. Any of these object methods can access this static data, provided that it's also public, because static data belongs to the class and not to any specific object instance of the class. Also, for the same reasons, object methods can access static methods of their own class or any other class, again provided that those methods are also public, by using class.method notation as shown here. Okay, that's enough on static methods for now. This has probably been a bit more information than we really need right now, but now we're in a position to look at some static class examples and make better sense of all this.